The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Rejoicing in Christ's victory over sin and death, let us come before God who calls us to repentance. O God of life, by the resurrection of your Son, you make everything new. Newness scares us, and we confess to shutting our doors in fear. We have not listened to voices that challenge us. We have resisted the Holy Spirit, moving us in new directions. Our hearts are slow to believe your promises. Forgive us, O God, and renew us to embrace without fear the new life you have given us in Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear people of God, Christ is alive, and death has lost its power. Through the waters of holy baptism, you have been born anew by the living Word of God. Know that your sins are forgiven in Jesus' name, and that the Spirit of the risen Christ is alive in you, both now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord God, you teach us that without love, our actions gain nothing. Pour into our hearts your most excellent gift of love, that made alive by your Spirit, we may know goodness and peace. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Holy Scripture.
The first lesson for today comes from the book of Acts, the 11th chapter. Now the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So when Peter went to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them?" Then Peter began to explain to them, step by step, saying, I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being lowered by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it closely, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, and birds of the air. I also heard a voice saying to me, Get up, Peter, kill and eat. But I replied, By no means, Lord, for nothing profane or unclean has ever entered my mouth. But a second time, the voice answered from heaven, What God has made clean, you must not call profane. This happened three times. Then everything was pulled up again to heaven. At that very moment, three men sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them and to not make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved. And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, just as it had upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, John baptized with water, but you will baptize with the Holy Spirit. If then God gave them the same gift that he gives us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that could hinder God? When they had heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life. The word of the Lord.
Wind doing God's will, mountains and all.
The second lesson for today comes from the book of Revelation, the 21st chapter. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of the Lord is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also, he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to St. John, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I'm with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. I invite the children up for the children's message. Anybody want to come on up?
Anybody 30 or under counts as a child. Actually, we're all children. All right. How are you? Good.
The wheels have fallen off the wagon, haven't they? Yes. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Yes. How many of you are movie buffs? You enjoy watching movies? Maybe you're aficionados. Maybe you just enjoy watching movies. And there are all kinds of movies, right? You might like old movies, like from the 40s and 50s. There's kind of a niche group who enjoy those movies. Maybe like books, mysteries or dramas or comedies or adventures, whatever they may be. Now, while many movies are quickly forgotten, and by forgotten I mean you get to the end of a movie and you say, 2 hours of my life I spent on this? My wife yelled that out the other day. I was working in the office and I come out and I hear this, oh! And she said, I just wasted 2 hours of my life. I'll never get back. Was it a lousy ending or a lousy movie? You kept waiting for it to get better. Yeah, we've all kind of been there and done that, right? Other movies, though, have provided lines that have made it into our culture, have made it into our culture, and we recognize the phrases, and they kind of have a meaning behind them. Take, for example, The Wizard of Oz, 1939. Now, remember, that was the first picture in color, first movie in color. Can you imagine in 1939 going to a movie theater and the first third's in black and white, but then as soon as Dorothy lands in Oz, everything becomes this technicolor? That would have been an amazing experience, wouldn't it? Whoa. But there are all kinds of famous lines that come from The Wizard of Oz. Anybody remember any of those? Okay. No place like home. Click and read. Pardon me? Dale, you mentioned, or Dale's there, Carl's there. Sorry. We're not in Kansas anymore. That's the one that comes to my mind first. Remember, Dorothy says to Toto, we're not in Kansas anymore. And it's a kind of a word about change, right? I'll bet you've thought that to yourself a couple of times over the last couple of years. Yeah? We're not in Kansas anymore. Yes. If I only had a brain, you know, I will find myself humming that to myself without even thinking about it. You know, dun, 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 dun. Yeah, it's scary. Okay, Wizard of Oz. We've got a bunch of that for Wizard of Oz. Things have changed, right? Casablanca, 1948. It's kind of a romantic line. What is it? Lisa's shaking her head no. Oh, you have, okay. Well, you're just a child. You haven't seen it. I'm sorry. That wasn't. What? Humphrey Bogart. Oh, Play It Again, Sam. That's one. I wasn't thinking of that one, but Play It Again, Sam. We hear that. Here's Looking at You, Kid. Right? But you got to sound like Humphrey Bogart when you do it, so you got to do that. Cool Hand Luke, 1967. You know Paul Newman? And it's a line by the warden. You don't know Paul Newman? Okay. Yes, the warden says at one point, what we've got here is a failure to communicate. Doesn't that relate to today too? I would say it probably does in all kinds of different levels. Last one, I promise. Zoolander from 2001. This might be one, depending upon your taste, this might be one where you get to the end of it and say you've wasted 2 hours of your life. But there's one particular line in here that is memorable. Will Ferrell, his character, says, I feel like I'm taking crazy pills. I feel like, and that's another one that's kind of bumped up, and I think in our culture the last couple years, although I prefer the edited edition, which is, I feel like everybody else is taking crazy pills. So the world of movies, I mean, we get all kinds of lines that affect us, right? But movies, thank the good Lord, are not the only place we get lines that shape our lives. Scripture is full of incredible, beautiful, great phrases and passages that we remember, lines that shape our lives. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And really, we could include the entire Psalm 23. We don't have to stop there. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Isn't that beautiful? Paul, 1 Corinthians. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Paul again, his letter to the Philippians. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. That's chapter 4, verse 13. And in Romans, we know that all things work together for the good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. And of course, the verse that Martin Luther called the gospel in miniature, John 3, 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but may have eternal life. And even today's gospel lesson, Jesus' words, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. Even as I have loved you, you also love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, my followers, if you have love for one another. So very many throughout all of Scripture. Why do these lines in Scripture resonate with us? What's so special about them? And all the 1,000 other beautiful lines in the Bible. Lines that even folks who aren't familiar with the Christian faith or maybe don't even believe in God, they've heard of John 3:16. Lines that shape our lives. Well, for starters, they resonate with us and they shape our lives because they're true. They are true. They capture and describe important insights about God's nature and us, about his love for us and us. The Lord is as caring and protective toward us as a good shepherd is toward his sheep. God really does watch over us, making plans for our welfare. Christ truly does empower us and strengthen us to face all of life's challenges. You know, a verse that, you know, I've been carrying around in my head for months, John chapter 16, verse 33. In this world, you will have trouble. In parentheses, bank on it. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart and be of good courage, for I have overcome the world. That's one to take with you everywhere you go. Everywhere you go. And all things do work out for the good for those who love and serve the Lord, even in the worst of times. These lines are concise truths that summarize even bigger truths. Lines that shape our lives. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son so that whosoever should believe in him should not perish but have eternal life. That is, see the gift of God in Christ Jesus. Receive that gift. Believe in the gift. Trust the gift. Follow the gift. Our Lord Jesus. Because you see, here is the truth. Jesus, God in Christ Jesus, God's word in flesh and blood, is the only one who can get you and me where we need to be and where we want to be. Another line, Acts chapter 4, verse 12. There is no other name by which we can be saved. No other name by which we can be saved. And boy, oh boy, does this world need saving. So in our gospel text for today from John 13, we're actually going back in time a bit. Now we're before Easter. We're reflecting back to Maundy Thursday, Jesus' marching orders to the disciples. And the disciples at this point, they've already decided to follow Jesus. Not perfectly, mind you. There will be twists and turns ahead, as in your faith journey and my faith journey. And by the way, just before our gospel lesson for today, the text tells us that Judas has left the upper room to go betray Jesus. So our gospel lesson is the first thing Jesus says to the rest of the disciples who still remain with him. And Jesus knows that Judas has just decided, by the way, to unfollow Jesus. He's unfollowed Jesus. And Jesus knows that the rest are going to deny him and run away too, but he knows that they will come back. So he gives them, in the midst of all this, a new command that they love one another as he has loved them. And it's a command not just for them, but for you and for me as well. It's a line that shapes our lives. A couple of points. First is this. Jesus has talked about the need to love a lot. I mean, you look throughout the New Testament, he's always talking about the calling for us to love others. What makes this different here at the end of his ministry? Well, the Old Testament version of this, and leading up to this, the command was love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. Now, that's a deep kind of love. I mean, that means we don't put ourselves first. That means that, you know, our neighbors are important. We take care of them, that kind of thing. It's a deep level of love. But what makes this now a new covenant is that we love one another as God in Christ has loved us, not as we love ourselves. The word for love that Jesus uses here is agape. It's agape, and we've all heard of agape before, right? Excuse me. It is the most profound love one can imagine. And for us to pull off that kind of love, we must abide. We must remain in him. And we're not going to be perfect at it. We're going to fail on occasion, and some of those failures are going to be epic. But our goal must be to agape one another. Teenager came home from church choir practice early one evening, and his dad said to him, "Son, what brings you back home so soon?" And his son replied, "Oh, we had to call off choir practice this week, Dad. The organist and choir director got into a terrible heated argument about how to sing 'Let There Be Peace on Earth.'" Now, we have solved that problem because Chad is both choir director and organist. But if you do see him wandering around talking to himself, like having a running argument, you'll know what that might be about. Now, what makes agape so special? Well, here's the thing. It's special because agape love is a decision. It's a decision. A decision to love no matter what. You know, you get up in the morning and you decide what, you know, if you're in any kind of situation, you already know how you're going to respond. I'm going to decide to be joyful today no matter what happens. That's kind of like agape. It isn't a feeling. It's not a love that loves if the other person treats us well. It's not a Hollywood love. What's that song? Is it Hollow Notes? You've lost that loving feeling. Oh, that loving feeling. You know, move on to the next. That's not agape. It's a love that agapes even if the other one wishes us harm. What is so special about this agape is that we are called to do it even for whatever reason we don't like the other person so much. If our personalities clash, if our political viewpoints are different, this agape love is not dependent on agreeing with one another. In fact, what makes it so special is it loves in spite of that stuff that we might not agree about. And if we as followers of Jesus, if we take this command seriously, instead of Simon says, Jesus says, right? And we use Jesus as our model to love like him, we will stick out like sore thumbs in this world. We will stick out like sore thumbs in this world that thinks this concept of agape love is ridiculous and absurd. Even some Christians will think it's crazy. But the world will know this, that we are followers of Jesus. We are Christians because who else would strive to love like that. So what are some characteristics of this agape of Jesus, this love of Jesus? It's first of all unchangeable, unchangeable. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God's love for you never changes, never changes. There's nothing more you can do for God to love you more. God loves you eternally and forever and always. It never changes. It's a divine love, which means, you know, we need to allow the Holy Spirit to rule our lives. We need to let the Holy Spirit rule our lives. Self-sacrificing, Holy Week, Christ's passion, and the cross. Are we self-sacrificing in our love? Inseparable. Romans chapter 8. Nothing can separate us from the love of God, the agape of God in Christ Jesus. Not height or depth or angels or demons, nor power, nor anything under creation can separate us from God's love in Christ Jesus. Impartial is agape love. Now, we have that in our first lesson, right? Peter, I love that. I love that passage. Our first lesson, Acts chapter 11. Peter has been called on the carpet. His Jewish Christian, the council at Jerusalem, has said, Peter, we have heard that you have been proclaiming the gospel to Gentiles. That would be us. Those Gentile dogs, you are proclaiming the gospel to. And Peter said, well, let me tell you step by step what happened here. I was doing just that. And then God gave me this vision of this sheet coming down, and on the sheet were all these clothed, four-footed creatures, reptiles and everything else. And God says, kill and eat, Peter. And I said, I've never touched anything that's unclean, Lord. And God said to me, there's nothing I've ever created that is unclean. And so as I was scratching my head wondering what that was about, three men came, knocked on my door and said, Cornelius the centurion, also a Gentile, is a believer in God and wants his family to be baptized and he wants to hear the gospel. And Peter said, oh, if that's not a message, that dream, I don't know what is. And so off he goes. And he tells this story to the council, and I love the council's response. Did you catch it when Carl was reading it? Let me get to it here real quick. Come on, where are you? There you are. When they heard this, that's the council, Jerusalem council, they were silenced after Peter told them the story. And they praised God, saying, then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life. Go figure. Go figure. Impartial. And you know, we're tempted all the time to treat people differently because of their money, position, rank, or lack thereof, color of skin, whatever it might be. And then this agape is abounding and fervent. A couple of passages from Scripture. Again, lines that shape our life. 1 Peter, this is chapter 1. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for one another, love one another deeply from the heart, for you've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living, enduring word of God. The word of the Lord endures forever. And 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. May he strengthen your heart so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones, abounding and fervent. I'd like to close with this. An artist purchased a new home. And loved the home, but there was a large landscaping boulder in his front yard, and he wasn't quite sure what he wanted to do with it. It was ugly, so he had to do something with it. So he got an idea. He pulled out his rock carving tools, chiseling tools, and he chiseled and chipped away, and he created this beautiful elephant sculpture. Just beautiful. And one of his neighbors came by and said, that's beautiful. You were chipping away, and I was watching. How did you do that? And the artist said, well, I looked at the stone and I saw an elephant. And I chipped away everything that didn't look like an elephant. What is it that you and I need to chip away from our lives that doesn't look like love? Selfishness, prejudice, anger, envy, unforgiveness. Brothers and sisters, let God chip away everything out of your life that doesn't look like grace, mercy, forgiveness, agape. Why? So that the world may see and know that we are followers of Jesus, and that they too may choose to follow him in agape, grace, truth, and mercy. Amen.
We confess our holy Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to the God of resurrection for the church, the world, and all people in need. Loving God, lead us to follow your Spirit rather than our own prejudices or desires, as the church is called to care for one another. God, in your mercy. Creator God, inspire us to praise you through the beauty and majesty of the natural world around us, and urge us toward more delicate care and deliberate care of the world that you have made. God, in your mercy. Ruling God, humble the rulers of the nations. Direct them to those people who need their attention most, and turn them from the temptation to hoard wealth or power. God, in your mercy. Great physician, hasten to dwell among those who are in pain or distress. As Christ enters their deepest suffering, remain with those experiencing despair and great need. God, in your mercy. Merciful God, place your holy love at the center of all our relationships and communities. By your love, heal us and renew us. Bring an end to racism and all that divides our churches and our communities. Let everyone know your will by the love that we show one another. God, in your mercy. As you promise us a place in the company of your beloved saints, teach us the value of each person's being, and bless us with our shared identity as your children, as brothers and sisters with Jesus Christ our Lord. God, in your mercy. And Heavenly Father, we pause for a moment to remember our friends and colleagues in the Ukraine. Please bless them with peace and an end to war. And we also ask your blessings upon all of the families that have incurred the tragedy in Buffalo, New York yesterday. It's just hard to understand how and why one person can take out a dozen or more people. We ask that you will be with all of those families that are affected by the tragedies. God, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we ask through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. And again, a very special welcome. We're so glad to have you with us today, both here in the sanctuary and online. A couple of announcements to share. This Tuesday evening at 7 p.m., we will have our third congregational discussion with the Vision Team. this one dealing with our mission as the body of Christ. Please plan to join us in the gathering place at 7 o'clock or via Zoom, and that Zoom link is available on the emailed announcements. We are still in desperate need of volunteers to assist with the 4 mornings of Vacation Bible School scheduled for July 11 to 14, but it will not be possible without additional help. Please read the article in today's announcements and contact Deacon Diane for further information. Next Sunday following this service, there will be a picnic for all Sunday school and youth group families. Again, following 11 o'clock next Sunday, and details are in the printed announcements. And finally, Pastor Tim's Bible study continues. They're dealing with the book of James, and that is via Zoom on Wednesday evening at 6 o'clock. And that Zoom link will be in the emailed announcements. Mr. Baker.
Before the choir sings their anthem this morning, we wanted to take just a moment to recognize Robin Tershak, who has been our faithful cantor and faithful soprano section leader and choral scholar, really since we reopened worship after being closed for COVID. This is Robin's last Sunday with us as she graduated from Capitol last week. We're hoping for a job here in Columbus, so keep that on your prayer list. But for now, Robin, we have a present for you, and we want to thank you for leading us in music all of these years, and know that you always have a home here with us at Christ Lutheran.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, and with all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And we pray together as our Lord taught us, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Please be seated. We continue to use the little chalices for our form of Holy Communion. Just peel back the top for access to the wafer. Eat the wafer, tip it upside down, peel back to access the grape juice. You can do that here in the front at the altar and the communion rail. You can either stand or kneel here, or you can take the little chalice back to the pew with you and commune yourselves there. Wherever that is, though, remember that this is the body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. Please rise for the blessing. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. And now, do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia, yes. Go in peace, my friends, and share the great news of God's love. Thanks be to God.